Your love, your love, never ending. Oh, 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 yeah, you are alive. right, first Wednesday. How you guys doing tonight? Y'all feeling all right? We ready to worship? Fantastic. Well, hey, you may have noticed we are being led tonight by the Freedom Church worship team. So give it up for Freedom Church. You know, about 2.5 years ago, we planted a church up in Monk's Corner, and God has just been doing incredible things. And we talk a lot at Seacoast about the churches that we planted. And tonight, we wanted to not only talk about it, but show you the church that we planted. And so we're just thrilled to have Freedom Church in the house tonight. Is anybody here in the congregation from Freedom Church? You guys, any of y'all show up? Okay, good. A little bit of energy. You know, we're excited about you guys being in the house, and we're excited about First Wednesday. More than anything, we're excited because Jesus is in the house tonight, and we are going to worship him with everything we got. I don't know if you've ever been to a First Wednesday before, but, you know, Cody said that Freedom Church, the guys in Monk's Corner, they like to dance. There really aren't any rules around worship at First Wednesday. So if you want to dance, you can dance. If you want to shout, you can shout. If you want to get on your knees, you can get on your knees. If you're the only one in the house doing it, think twice about it, but if you still need to do it, you can do that. Let's try not to hurt anybody. Let's try not to do any physical harm, but we're just excited. In fact, I read a scripture, and Pastor Ron Hamilton of our West Campus shared this with me yesterday, and it's just stuck with me. I've been thinking about it a lot, and I think it really embodies what we want to see happen at First Wednesday. It's Isaiah 40 in verse 9. It says, "Shout from the mountaintops." Can you guys shout? Anybody got a shout in them? Woo! Okay. Then it says, "Shout it louder." We got a louder one? Woo! "Oh, Jerusalem, why?" It says, "Shout and do not be afraid. Tell the towns of Judah, your God is coming. Yes, the sovereign Lord is coming in power." Seacoast and Freedom Church, your God is coming. In fact, he's already here. And he wants to meet with us in a powerful way. He wants to meet with us in power. And so I just want to encourage you, whether it's been one of those weeks that you'd like to move on to the next one, or whether it's been a fantastic time and you're all geared up and fired up about Christmas coming and all that, let's just put all of that aside, and let's expect and anticipate that we're going to meet with the sovereign God of the universe this evening. You guys okay with that? Yeah. All right. I want to pray for us, and we're gonna jump in. God, we want to shout it from the mountaintops. Lord, it may not reach Judah, but we want Mount Pleasant to know that you are here. And we want Monk's Corner to know that you are here. The sovereign Lord has come, and he's come in power. Lord, would you meet with us tonight? We're going to lay everything aside that we may have carried, burdens that we had, thoughts, things that are consuming our minds tonight, maybe issues with the family. We're leaving them all alone. Lord, you're above all of that. We're lifting our eyes. We're getting up to the top of that mountain, and we want to shout it out. We want to shout out with everything that we have that you are here and that we are your people. You are our God. We are your people. We want to meet with you tonight. So would you meet with each of us in our individual way? And Lord, just fill this place. Make this place a house of worship and a house of praise. We love you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, well, high five a couple of people, and we are going to worship with the Freedom Church band tonight.
Yeah. everybody doing all right? Amen. I'm going to tell you guys a quick story, if that'd be okay. A little over a year ago, we were getting ready to celebrate our first year anniversary as a church. And we were just so excited. We were expecting over 500 people in attendance, and we were expecting just a big move of God. And that Monday prior to that service, our pastor, Pastor Sean, received a phone call where he was told that our trailer, our portable trailer for our portable church, was stolen. Over $35,000 worth of equipment had been taken 6 days before our biggest event at our church. And as this is happening, you know, the least to say, it was incredibly discouraging and disheartening. And I remember looking at 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13. It says, "When we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself." Amen. What an incredible scripture. And so a week after that, we sat down, we wrote a song to kind of put as a milestone, as a mile marker, to remind ourselves that God is faithful. And that within that 6 days, because of generous gifts, including one from this church, we were able to replace all of that equipment because God is faithful. And so we'd like to share that song with you today, because all of us are coming into this room from different areas of life, going through different situations, and some of us we're hurting, we're in trouble, we need help. We need a God who is faithful even when we are faithless. And the great thing about our God is that even when we fail, he does not, because he can do all things but fail. When we are faithless, he remains faithful. So wherever you are today, no matter what you're going through, remember that he is faithful and he does not fail. Amen.
Tired and weak, you carry me.
God, we declare that tonight. You are faithful. Lord, if you said it, we can take it to the bank. God, we just trust in you. You can't be moved. You are so faithful, and we thank you for that, God. You are faithful. You are faithful. You know, some of us that are here tonight, we're singing those words from a place of having just come through a storm or a trial or a situation where we knew God's faithfulness. And you're singing that, and you're full of faith, and you're believing that. And it's more of a song of thanksgiving about something that God has done for you. And that's awesome. There's others of us that we're here tonight, and we're singing that, but it's really a song of faith. And it's we want to believe it, but we may not even fully believe it right now because the circumstances that we're in maybe seem overwhelming. We feel tired. We feel weary. Maybe we feel like Freedom Church felt when they got the phone call that the stuff's gone and we got an event this week. And I just want us to maybe go back through, Cody, if you guys don't mind, go back through the chorus and bridge maybe one more time. And I just want to remind you, as Cody already did, that when we are faithless, he is faithful. So let's sing it, whether it's a song of thanksgiving again to remind ourselves. But for some of us, this is going to be a song that we need to just say these words in faith. We need to say these words, but don't say them if you don't believe them. Don't say them if you don't know that the God that raised Jesus from the dead, that power, according to Ephesians, is available to us in our circumstances, and that when we do remain faithless, that he is faithful. So let's just sing that chorus one more time.
Through the highest waves, through the highest waves, the darkest days, you did not fail, you did not fail. Need you most, you remain close, you do not fail, you do not fail. I was dancing, carrying me, you do not fail, you do not fail. I was dead inside, you restored my life, you do not fail, you do not fail.
Highest waves,
highest waves, darkest days, you do not fail, you do not fail. When I need you most, you remain close.
Amen. Amen. You know, for a lot of us, that's the word you needed tonight. You can go home, but I don't want you to, because we've got just an incredible night. Thank you, Freedom Church, for helping lead us into worship. That song is going to be a gift to the body of Christ. It already has been to Freedom Church, but that song is going to be a gift to the body of Christ. I just feel it, sense it, believe it. Why don't you guys go ahead and grab a seat for a moment. I'm going to introduce our speaker tonight. It's a mystery, I'm sure. You know, if Greg were here, he would introduce Sean kind of as one of the sons of the house. Sean Wood has been a part of our family for a long time. And for me, he's more of a brother of the house. You know, we came on staff actually the same year, I believe, 2001. And that was my second time on staff. I'd been fired once, but he had not. That was his first time. And Sean came in and he led our student ministry so well for a number of years. He was a part of our teaching team. He has led our communications department. He's been an armor bearer and continues to be for my dad, for Greg, continues to be a very close friend to Greg. And about 2 or 3 years ago, Sean began to feel a desire to plant a church. And that happens from time to time. And oftentimes it'll be kind of a season, it'll go away. But Sean had a desire to plant a church in Monk's Corner. And we knew that had to be God, because that's not something that you just dream up. No, I'm kidding. We love Monk's Corner. But we began to pray and process with him in that. And they launched Freedom Church about 2.5 years ago. And it's just nothing short of a miracle to see what God has done up in Monk's Corner, and seeing the growth of the church and the stories. And so, like I said in the welcome, we always tell you about the church plants that you guys are a part of. By your generosity, your giving goes towards planting churches. 2% of our budget goes to the Ark and planting churches. And then more than that goes to went towards helping Sean and then plant Freedom Church. But we wanted, again, to show you and to allow you to experience some of what God is doing through our church planting movement, and especially through Sean. So would you guys, Seacoast, help me welcome back Sean Wood as he comes to share with us tonight.
Thank you, guys. Y'all can have a seat. Thank you so much. It's great to be home. It's kind of feels strange. 2.5 years goes by fast. You guys know that. I've gotten better looking, though, so that's okay. That's happened. But Connie and I are just so grateful to be back. I said the other day to someone, I said, I am so looking forward to my Freedom family, getting to meet my Seacoast family. It's going to be like a family reunion, so to speak, you know. And in Berkeley County, we like our family reunions, so we are excited about it. I mean, you can get married at a family reunion if you're not, you know, if you do it well. So we like to do that, and we are excited about being here. And speaking of kind of family reunions, it was about, I guess I was about 21 years old, and Connie and I packed up all of our belongings, and we left our families, and we moved to Wake Forest, North Carolina, to go to seminary. We had just gotten married just a few months prior to that. We were newlyweds for just a few months. Had finished up my college degree over at CSU, and now we were going to do seminary. And just a few months prior to that, my grandfather, who was very influential in my life, just a big part of raising me, like a dad to me in many ways, had been diagnosed with terminally ill cancer. And so it was a really hard time because I knew God had put a calling on our lives and we were supposed to go to seminary, but I also knew that back home things were hard right then, and it was a kind of a devastating blow to our family. And so it was a hard thing. But I remember my grandfather sitting me down and he said, "You're not going to sit here and wait on me to die. You're going to go to seminary. We'll get things straight here. You go and you go start your degree." And so when Ralph Butler said something, you listen. That's kind of how it worked. And so we headed up to Wake Forest, North Carolina. And it wasn't long that we had been there while he was still healthy enough to travel and still doing well enough that he could make his way up there, that a couple of my family members brought my grandfather up to see where we were living and to kind of experience our new home and to really get to have a chance to spend some time with us. And as you can imagine, it was just a sweet time. It was a good time, and of just getting to show him around where we were and showing him our house. And you know, there was this kind of a nice, nice moment. And towards the end of the visit, he stood up and he asked me if I would join him on the porch. He said, "Hey, will you come out to the porch with me?" Now, if I'm just being honest, it was probably so he could smoke a cigarette. Like, that's probably what was going on there. And so we went out to the porch and we had just this kind of this man conversation. Do you guys know what I mean by a man conversation? There was not a lot said, you know, verbally, but there was a lot said. Do you know what I'm talking about? And so Ralph Butler would always lean over the fence, and he would always have a cigarette in his hand, and he would lean over, and he would talk while he kind of leaned over the fence. He was all of 5'7". He claimed 5'9", but he was all of 5'7", and so that was real comfortable for him. And we sat there on that porch, and we had just a great conversation. It really was. And it really was lacking in words, but there was a lot that was said. And I thought about that porch conversation. Porch conversations are great conversations. In my community group, the girls split off from the guys at some point, and they go into a room where they have lots of Kleenex, and they cry and stuff. And the guys, we go out on the back screen porch and we just talk about college football and different things that are going on, and we see how God moves in our lives out there on the porch. Porches are good places to have conversations. Well, in this conversation, there was a lot that was implied in this conversation, a lot that was happening on the porch. The first thing is that talking on the porch that day with my grandfather was very intimate. There was something about the moment that it was special. You couldn't really capture it in words to say why. Now, no one would accuse my grandfather of being kind of an emotional guy. He wasn't the most emotional person that you had ever met. And for me, honestly, it would have been easier to kind of just stay distant, to kind of say, okay, I don't want to get into that conversation, but kind of going out on the porch, it was intimate. It was an intimate conversation. Talking on the porch also not just had intimacy, but there was a finality to it. There was something about it that was final. We kind of knew that this was his way of having a final conversation He lived about 3 hours away from Wake Forest, of course, here in the Lowcountry. And we would travel back and forth as often as we could. But I just kind of get the feeling, and I got the feeling then, that he knew this was probably going to be, if not the one of the last conversations we would have. In fact, he would die just little less than 3 months after this conversation. And this would be the last conversation that I would have with him outside of a hospital. And so there was just the finality to this. There was a line that we were crossing in this conversation, and there was really no turning back because we kind of both knew what was going on. And then the other thing is, talking on the porch, it was really an acceptance of responsibility. You know, you guys, if you've ever kind of had to walk through maybe a death of a parent or a death of a grandparent who's very close to you, or maybe even a spouse, that you just, you know, there's something, that there's a handing off of the responsibility. And my grandfather was very much, I would say, the rock of our family. And there was just something about this porch conversation that said, you know what, you've got some responsibility now. This is, I know you're a young man, but you're going to have to take some of the manliness of this family, and you're going to have to accept some responsibility. It was something that he was inviting me into, but I had to accept that responsibility. A couple of months ago, I stumbled across this passage in Scripture when I was studying for a sermon, and it was actually a related Scripture to what I was preaching on, but it really wasn't the central Scripture that I was preaching on, and I actually stumbled across it. I mean, I read it when I was studying, but it was in the midst of preaching, and I'm a very planned out person. Like, some have accused me of being OCD, and I accept that very, very proudly, and so I'm very planned out, and I don't, like, shoot from the hip a whole bunch. I just, it's not what I do, and so during the midst of a sermon, for me to kind of get an idea and kind of go with it was a big deal, and I had this deal where I was reading the Scripture, and it's like God just kind of dropped something into my spirit, and I kind of went off on it for just a few minutes, and I felt like it was kind of a big idea for me. And the Scripture was in Acts chapter 5. If you have your Bibles, you're welcome to turn there. We'll be in verse 12 just for a moment, or to be on the side screens in just a second too. But it's Acts chapter 5, and there's this time period that's going on where lots of stuff is going on in the early church. Cool stuff is happening. I mean, there's people being healed. There is power that's being seen. There is a new and invigorating movement that is happening. I mean, this is a big time, and it's a big deal. And then Acts chapter 5 finds us there. In Acts chapter 5, verse 12, it says, "Now many signs and wonders were regularly done among the people by the hands of the apostles, and they were all together on Solomon's porch. But listen, none of the rest dared join them." That statement just hit me. None of the rest dared join them. So the disciples are in the midst of God's moving. I mean, they're in the midst of drawing close to God in a new way, with the power and the presence of God and healing and things going on. And they're on Solomon's porch. They're having a porch conversation. And then it says, but none of the rest dared join them. It's just kind of a peculiar thing to look at. They didn't dare to join them. I noticed a couple things about this encounter on the porch. The first thing is, I noticed that the Scripture doesn't indicate in any way that the apostles wouldn't allow them to join them on the porch. It doesn't say that they barricaded it off or that they didn't have room for anybody else to join. In fact, we know that others would join this movement. We know that hundreds and thousands and now millions of people would join this movement. And so it wasn't blocked off. The apostles didn't do that. It doesn't seem to indicate anywhere that God didn't want anyone else to join this movement. It seems to strongly indicate, in fact, that it was the people who weren't on the porch, who weren't involved in this moving of God, who decided, who didn't dare to get involved in what God was doing. So it indicates that these people were watching God do amazing things, to move in miraculous ways, and that these men and women, they just didn't dare join them. They kind of stood back from a distance. They didn't come on to the porch conversation. for some reason, they felt like the porch was not a place for them. And we could speculate all day what those reasons are, and I think we could come up with a long list of them. But I think there was something that said, we can't go there. I wonder if sometimes, just like these men and women who watched from a distance, who didn't pull in close, who didn't get involved in what God was doing, if maybe sometimes we miss out on what God has for us because we watch what God is doing in others from a distance and we marvel at it. We think it's really cool. We think, wow, I wish God could move in me like that, but we never dare to join them on the porch. And it's amazing what can happen once you join God in the movement that he has going on. We see it throughout scripture. I also think about some invitations onto the porch I've had in my journey. I'll turn 40 years old just in a few months, and God has walked with me through some incredible adventures to be able to join him. Some where I have sat from a distance and literally watched other people enjoy the favor of God and marveled at what God was doing with them, but thought that could never be me that God would move through. And then I had a unique opportunity, and that unique opportunity happened about 13 years ago. And it was when I walked past this porch. And I kind of walked past, and my parents had started attending Seacoast Church, and my dad, Cliff, was telling me all about it, and he was always bragging about what was going on. And we were in Dallas, Texas, finishing up seminary, because one seminary wasn't enough for me. I had to go to three. And so we were finishing up seminary, and he would tell me all about what was going on at the Seacoast Church. And I started learning. I said, man, I'd love to get to know more about that. I'd love to learn more about it. And so I had an opportunity, and I'll never be able to thank him enough for this. My dad had worked hard to get through Joan Lesky to get an appointment with Pastor Greg. And he had been setting this appointment up for a long time, and he was supposed to have lunch with him. And he graciously said to me, why don't you come along, and let me let you meet Pastor Greg. And so it was October the 11th of 1999 that I was able to go to lunch at the Chili's that they've now torn down. How dare them. The Chili's that has now been torn down, but they replaced it with Pff Chang, so that's good. I'm glad they did that. And so we were there, and I had this lunch, and as I listened to Pastor Greg, I'll be honest with you, I thought, I want to come on this porch. I don't know what's going on here. I don't quite understand it. I wasn't from this flow of church. I wasn't a part of anything like this happening. But I thought, I want to be there. And so I started praying. We started talking. And before long, in October of 2001, an opportunity would come 13 years ago for me to come on staff here at Seacoast Church. And I just want to thank Pastor Greg, who I think is watching maybe through the internet right now. I want to thank you. I want to thank Debbie. I want to thank the rest of the staff that was here. That you guys took a challenge, I mean, just a risk on a young 27-year-old guy who didn't know anything. I mean, honestly, I knew how to talk myself into an interview. You know what I'm talking about? You guys have done that before. They're like, can you do this? You're like, absolutely. Then you walk away and you go and Google it. And we didn't even have Google then, right? And so I talked myself into getting a job here, and probably pretty soon they realized, you know, he's not quite as sharp as we thought he was. But they hung on to me. They worked with me. They walked with me through stuff. And I just want to thank Pastor Greg for letting me come onto the porch. And there were moments where we would have porch conversations where he poured into me. And over the 13 years together, taking a risk on Connie and I, believing in us, loving our family, I just can't thank Pastor Greg enough for that. And so 13 years ago, I fell in love with this place. I saw what God was doing, and I started to walk past meetings that were going on that I had just a hunch. And Josh was in the same boat. We weren't allowed into a lot of meetings back in that day. And we would walk past those meetings, and we would think, we had a hunch that something special was going on in there and that God was going to change the world because of some of the meetings that were going on. I thought, I want to get on the porch. I want to be involved in what's going on there. And then 3 years ago, the team here at Seacoast got behind Connie and I when we came and said, we think we want to plant a church. Now, that is fairly common here because Pastor Greg loves church planting, and he's the greatest champion of all who want a church plant. But let me tell you, we planted a church 30 minutes away. That doesn't happen in church world. There aren't many out there who go, yeah, go just down the street just a little ways and you plant a church. But I remember taking a drive with Pastor Greg one morning and we drove around Berkeley County and we drove through Monk's Corner and he said, I want you to stay, but is this where God's leading you? And I said, I really think it is. And he said, then I'm your biggest fan. I'm your biggest champion. We'll do whatever it takes to be behind you. And yeah, that would be a great, that was a golf clap. Pastor Greg, that's for you. And then the church staff got behind it. And I remember being on staff. This is a large church. Did you guys know y'all are a large church? If you didn't know that, you're a large church. And so I remember being on staff here. And I'm just going to be quite, I'm going to be real honest, okay? This is just being honest because I don't work here anymore. So I can just be really, really honest, right? I remember being on staff and getting calls from some churches and just honestly being like, I honestly thought they're a little bit of a bother sometimes. I mean, really did. I had lots to do, and I thought they're a little bit of a bother. And I want to tell you that the staff here, we've called, we've emailed, we've begged, we've borrowed, we've stolen. We've done whatever we needed to do to get stuff. I mean, if it's laying around, I take the Sammy Leske adage. If it's laying around, it needs to be used somewhere, right? That's what needs to happen. And so we have done, I mean, we have called on everything. And the staff here, they love us. They support us. They may behind my back say, he's annoying, but they've never said it to me. And so I thank you for that. And let me tell you this. You guys didn't know it, but because you were one of the most generous churches that I've ever been a part of, Seacoast has been able to help us financially in a huge way. We were able to launch strong because you gave both to the Ark, which was a huge source of funding for us, and you guys support that in a big way. But then in addition to that, we were a son of the house, Pastor Greg said. And so he said, we're not just going to do the Ark funding. We're going to be behind you 100%. We are with you. And because of you guys giving, you're able to do that. And so 13 years ago, those are people who joined on the porch. You guys joined on the porch of anything that's happening at Freedom Church. And then let me just say, if you're from Freedom Church, if you're from Freedom Church, in fact, I'm going to break the rules here a little bit. Would you just stand up? Would you stand up if you're from Freedom Church? Stand up quick, because I'm going to get you to sit down. Now these, that's right. All right, you're cutting into my time. You're cutting into my time. All right, these are my heroes. Honestly, I mean, these guys, you talk about the porch adventure of what's going on here. These guys are my heroes because these folks have been a part of, listen to this, a part of 114 people being baptized in the last 2.5 years. Incredible. They have been a part of changing a county. They've been a part of seeing God move in incredible and unbelievable ways. And you know why? Because they joined us on the porch. They said, okay, we'll be a part of that. We'll join you on the porch. This is a group of people that had to do with one of my friends, a friend, in fact, who was far from God a little bit this time last year. Hadn't been to church in a long time. But because of the generosity of Freedom Church, because of your generosity of Seacoast and Pastor Greg being behind us and all the things that play into what God wanted us to do in this porch moment, he showed up with his family on Christmas Eve. And since Christmas Eve, his whole family has been baptized. And tonight, you got to see him playing drums back here with us. That's my buddy Josh. To which one of our leaders said, I didn't know you were allowed to have that many tattoos. That was kind of what they said about Josh. And I said, oh, you didn't even see them all. Like, he's got most of them hidden, so it's good. And he is just a story. He's a picture of what we're about at Freedom. Like, and you guys are a part of that because you joined us on the porch, and I can't thank you enough. And there's 113 other Joshes who can't thank you enough for what you've done and what you've been a part of, and letting us still be a part of the house. And this is because when you guys saw the meeting on the porch, you dared to get involved. Now, the others in this story that we read a few moments ago allowed fear or laziness, who knows what, to keep them from being a large part of the greatest movement in all of humanity. And they denied themselves of their ultimate destiny. because they weren't willing to step onto the porch. I wonder what keeps us. You know, it's easy to look back at them and go, well, they should have gotten on the porch. But I wonder what keeps us, you and I, off the porch. I wonder what keeps us and just says, I don't dare move in that close. I don't dare get there. I think it's the three same words that God kind of dropped into my heart about my porch meeting with my grandfather. The first is intimacy. You see, when we really press in to being a part of something bigger than ourselves, when we really, really get to know people, we'll have to be real. There is an intimacy that happens on the porch that doesn't happen out in the crowd. We like to illustrate it with this phrase at Freedom Church. We tell everybody they should be in community group. We say you need to be around a circle of people that at least some of them can tell you, you don't look good in biker shorts, right? I mean, not everybody needs to be able to tell you that, but you got to have at least one person who can tell you that. And there's an intimacy that comes with the porch. And I think sometimes we're afraid of somebody really knowing us. We're afraid of really being known by God. We're afraid of really pressing in. I think sometimes it's finality. I mean, when you take the step across the line, say, all right, I'm leaving the crowd that dares not come on. I'm going to dare to step onto the porch. There's some finality to it. I remember Connie and I praying through leaving Seacoast. And I say that word, and it doesn't even sound right because we haven't left Seacoast. We really haven't. We're part of the family, and we haven't. But we left here physically. And I remember us praying through it and talking about it, and it was, honestly, it was one of the most difficult decisions we ever had to make. If you'd asked me 4 years ago, will you ever leave Seacoast, I would have said, no way. Absolutely not. Our friends were here. Our family was here. Our relationships were here. We had joined the porch here. But I remember when we finally went from just conversations to some actions that started to spin some things into motion to a decision moment where it was like, okay, we got to decide. And there was some finality to joining the porch of Freedom Church. There was some finality to saying, okay, we're kind of walking across a line now, pressing into God, and we're getting close to him in a way that is going to make things different. It's going to be different. And so I just find in Scripture that there seems to always be some level of finality when people are asked to step onto the porch. No matter how big the movement or how small, I mean, when you are going to say, okay, God, I'm in. I'm ready to be a part of what you are doing. There's something you're going to leave behind. You can't go on to something new without something old having to pass away. And I believe sometimes that's why we really struggle with joining the porch. I think some of us here would say, you know, there's something that God has been moving in me. There's something he's been stirring in me. And I'm supposed to press in closer to him. I'm supposed to press in closer to what he's doing. But it's going to mean giving up something else. It's going to mean leaving something. There's just some finality to it. And I think the third word is responsibility. I think that there was some measure of comfort for being outside of the porch. There's some measure of comfort to being folded arms, being able to go, okay, that's cool. I like watching that. I'm an attender. I'm a consumer of what's going on, but maybe not a contributor to what's happening. But when you step onto the porch, you've got to be a contributor. You've got to bring your A game. You're part of the team now, and there's a responsibility that comes with it. There's a ownership mentality that comes with being in the smaller environment of the porch versus the safe and comfortable place of being on the outside. And if I'm just real, I think this is the main reason that people did not dare join them. I think this is really the place why they didn't join them on the porch, because being an attender is easier. Watching and following from a distance is far more comfortable. You can do that with very low responsibility. In fact, responsibility, you can say from afar, that's for somebody else. And I bet there were those who saw that and thought, well, that's a meeting for someone else on the porch. That's not for me. I mean, that whole miracles and people, you know, raising from the dead and sicknesses being healed and God moving and unbelievable. That's for them. But man, it's fun to watch. It's fun to consume. Do you dare join God in the porch conversation that he wants to have with you? You see, there's been hundreds and thousands of people before you here at Seacoast Church who have. And because they have, they've stepped across a line that has seen incredible, more than you could imagine, things happen. You guys just got to be a part of your 25th anniversary celebration, and I watched the documentary, and Connie and I sat and watched it, and we thought, what a cool ride. What an incredible ride. Well, there were people, as you learned, that were a part of the porch. They were on the porch. They were leading. There's a next 25 years to go. There's more churches to be planted. There's more young 27-year-olds coming on staff here who need someone to pour into them and believe in them. There's a younger generation of leadership rising up here that needs people behind them saying, we're on the porch with you. We're behind you for the next 25 years. We're going to see God do incredible and amazing things, but we want to be a part of it. We want to be involved in it. We're not interested in being outside. We want to dare to come onto the porch. I wonder if you would dare to be a part of a community group where someone will speak into your life, a small group environment. Some of you have put that off. You say, that's somebody else's deal. That's a porch conversation for somebody else. I wonder if for some of you, maybe you're fairly new to even First Wednesday, and you say, man, this is kind of more intense than the weekend. This is kind of gets going here at First Wednesday. There's people that are worshiping, and I wonder if you're willing to step onto the porch of people who get just a wee bit crazy, right? Just a little bit. Like, do you know, we should be just a little bit weird. The Bible tells us that. Just slightly weird. Not so weird that nobody wants to come, but just a little bit weird, right? And I wonder if some of you have allowed God to really move through you, to take a step into the waters that kind of the Holy Spirit just kind of swirl you around a little bit. It's uncomfortable and you worship at a new level. There's a porch conversation that maybe you've been invited to. I wonder, you know, you just went through the next series. If for some of you go, you know, I know what God's calling me to do in the area of giving, but I'm used to being a taker. I'm not a contributor. I'm a consumer. And God said, join us on the porch. We need everybody to join us on the porch. So would you come? Would you dare to be a part of it? And I wonder if for some of us, we're just afraid of really giving God everything, really pressing in to all that he is and saying, God, I need you. I need to be a part of where you are. There's not a place I'd rather be, God, than with you. There's nothing else that is going on. I wonder if there were people that literally were out and they had something better to do. I mean, you ever had something better to do? You know, I got something better to do than maybe press into what God wants me to have. And so you're going, these people are watching what's going on. They're seeing the meeting on the porch and they go, I've got something else to do. I've got something better to do. I wonder if for you, if you say, I know God's been moving in my heart to be a part of something bigger than myself, but I've got somewhere else to be. I've got a place that I would rather be. Or if you tonight would be bold enough and dare to say, there's no place that I would rather be. There's nothing else that I would rather do than press into the porch conversation with God. I wonder if you could be all in. We're in the midst of a capital campaign similar to Next at our church. We're building, hopefully, a building here in the next few months. We'll start, or weeks, hopefully, or days or something, who knows. And We had these opportunity to give pledge cards, and we're kind of in our family. We're all into this church thing, so we talk about church a lot, and we're talking about what's going on. And one day, I office at home, and I was in my office, and I was sitting in there. And Connie's done an incredible job of training the kids. We have an 8-year-old, a 4, almost 5-year-old, and a 2-year-old. But she's done an incredible job. They'll walk by and wave at me every now and then, like I'm in the fishbowl. But they don't really bother me. But unless the door's open, then they can come in anytime. But my almost 8-year-old came and knocked on the door ever so slightly, and I happened to not be in the middle of anything, and so I waved her in. And Isabel came in and she came in and she said, "Daddy, can I ask you something?" And I said, "Yeah, yeah, absolutely." She said, "I've been hearing you guys talk about these cards," and she had this card, this pledge card with her. And she said, "I've been hearing you talk about these cards, and will you help me fill out one?" And I said, "Absolutely, baby, I'll help you fill out one. That would be awesome." And so she said, "I've already got started on some of it," and she had filled in that for the end of the year giving, she's going to give $4. Now, to you, not a big deal. To an 8-year-old, that was wiping out most of the money I'd given her. You know, like kind of. And so $4. And then she put $2 over the next 24 months. We're going to work on that. We're going to speak into that. And she filled out her name and phone number and everything. And she kind of gave me the card. She said, "Can I turn it in at church when we're supposed to turn them in?" I said, "Absolutely." And I said, "Can you leave? Because my eyes are leaking a little bit. Can you just walk out for a moment?" And when she left, I sat there and I thought about it. I thought, you know what? She gets it. There's no place she'd rather be. I got a chance just a couple years ago to baptize Isabel right over here in the baptismal. She loves Jesus. And she doesn't understand everything that theologians would want her to understand yet, but she gets this. She gets this. There's no place she'd rather be than on the porch. There's no place she'd rather be than with God. I wonder if we'd make that our prayer tonight. There's no place I'd rather be. Would you sing it with me? There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than here in your love, here in your love. There's no place I'd rather. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than here in your love, here in your love. Sing that out to God. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than here in your love, here in your love. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be. There's no place I'd rather be than here in your love. Make this your prayer. Set a fire. Well, set a fire down in my soul.
I can't contain, I can't control.
No place I'd rather be. There's no
Find true freedom. It's in your presence that all of our fears are cast away from us. Your love drives out all fear. Your perfect love, Jesus. We thank you for that tonight. That there is no other thing that can ever stand in your presence, that can never stand before you, God, that all things will fall down in the presence
of our mighty King, Jesus. So Lord, may we just lift our voices to you and to you alone, that we'll worship you seated on your throne tonight, God, as our great I Am. The mountains will shake before you. The demons will flee at the very mention of your name. And there's nothing that will ever hold our God's love back. There's nothing that can hold his presence. So Lord, where your presence is where we want to be. And if your presence isn't there, we don't want to go. We just want to be with you. I want to be close, close to your side. So heaven is real and death is a lie. I want to hear voices of angels above singing as one. greater than all we see. He's greater than all we ask. As he has done great things, lifted up, he defeated the grave, raised to life. Our God is able. In his name we overcome. For the
I told you the Lord was going to meet us here. I told you he was going to meet us here. How about it one more time for Sean and Freedom Church? And they're not quite done yet, so don't leave too soon. We got one more song that they're going to do for us in a couple of minutes. But, you know, I don't know about you, but I'm on the porch. Are you guys going to join me? Let's get on the porch, whatever he's doing. And, you know, I think... thinking about what you guys are going through, we're going through both, kind of believing God for a vision for what's next for our church and expanded facilities and all that stuff. And I know one way that you can really show that you're on the porch, whether that's for Freedom Church or for Seacoast Church, is to step up and to make that commitment and be a part, get involved financially. And I know this weekend at Seacoast will be our last weekend that we kind of ask for commitments, because our first offering is going to be not this weekend, but the following one. And so I just encourage you to think and be praying about what's God calling you to do to get on the porch and be a part of what God's doing there. But there's another opportunity that I wanted to have John Holm come up and join us. Give it up for John. So I really want to challenge, John spoke, two or three months ago about student ministries and kind of shared some vision for where we're going. And I really just want to challenge our church to be about the next generation. I don't care if you're in your 70s, 80s, 50s, 30s, 20s, get involved with the next generation, because they need us to kind of be there for them. And we've got a lot to learn from them as well. So John, we got a pretty awesome event coming up next week that I just wanted you to tell the crew about. This is Sean's mic, guys.
I always have problems with mics for some reason. The 11th, which is next Wednesday, 7 o'clock the service starts. We're going to open the doors at 6:30. It's called, we're doing an event called The Reveal. Yeah. Woo. Yes. Woo. And we've been dropping little hints to the students, but the Reveal is for parents and students. So we would love for all of you to be in attendance. And if you don't have a student, maybe you have a child and you're kind of interested in what this is about, what the vision of the student ministry is about, you're welcome to come to that as well. We're going to be in here, and God's doing some new things.
Yep.
And we want to be a part of that. Actually, you know what? We want to be on the forefront of that. And so we're going to be laying out the new vision for the student ministry and what God has really dropped in the heart of our pastor and dropped in the heart of us and the student team. And we just want to share that with you. And you don't want to miss it, because we don't want you to feel left out and be left behind, because we're going to move forward with what God's doing. And so we're just excited.
Awesome.
About that.
So next Wednesday, 6:30?
6:30, the door's open. It starts at 7.
All right. Thank you, John.
Yep.
We really are excited about what God is doing in student ministries. And so I know Lisa and I have kids that are, one's in kindergarten, our oldest is in kindergarten, and the rest are there. But I'm excited because John's going to lay out a vision for what our plan is for students moving forward. And so we'll be there with bells on, and not only in support of the next generation, but as a parent, to be in support of how the church is planning on partnering with us as we navigate through the seasons of raising our children. And so I'd invite you to come. If some of you don't have kids, you just want to be a part, you want to hear the vision, you want to support the vision, you want to get involved in the vision, please come and be there. I'll give you a hint with the reveal. I'm not going to reveal anything. But if we're going to accomplish what we hope to accomplish through the reveal, it's going to take a lot of us being involved, not only just as cheerleaders, but as small group leaders, as people who'd be willing to invest our lives and pour our lives into the next generation. So come next week. It's going to be awesome. A couple more announcements. This coming weekend, we're kicking off a brand new series. How many of you get a little stressed out during the Christmas season? Just anybody admit to just a little bit. I mean, I love it, but a little stressful. We're doing a series that we're calling Pause. And you may not know this, but a well-timed pause can change the entire feel of your Christmas season. And so we want to talk about ways that God's calling us to stop in the midst of the greatness that is the Christmas season, so that we won't miss what God has for them. And so we kick it off this weekend. It's going to be awesome. We invite you guys to be a part of it. Next month, first Wednesday is January 1st. If you come to first Wednesday on January 1st, you will be the only one here. Because we're not doing first Wednesday on January 1st. We're doing second Wednesday in January, January the 8th. So come on. We'll let you know about that again later. But since you guys are already on the porch, you're part of the core, I wanted to make sure you guys knew that next month, January 8th, you can go ahead and be preparing for that. All right, we've got one more song. And this song is a song that was written by Freedom Church. And it's become kind of an anthem for Freedom Church. So let's sing it with them. Seacoast and Freedom, let's sing this out together.
Would you guys like to learn a new song? We're going to teach it to you, okay? So it goes like, yay. Thank you. That's helpful. All right, so we're going to teach it to you. It goes like this.
And this is who we are. We are your children. Are your children living in the dark? We once were blind, but now we see. And this is who we are. We once were slaves, but now we're free. In the tomb of Jesus Christ, it bears no bones. You got to sing it with us. And this is who we are. Come on. We are your children. Are your children living in the dark? We once were blind, but now we see. This is who we are. We once were slaves, but now we're free. In the tomb of Jesus Christ, it bears. Pain, my everything. Use it to build a kingdom.
guys have a wonderful week. Thank you for having us.
Those Christmas lights light up the street down where